So, if you check the website of FruNAS today, you will see it's like quite a big, very successful software. Now I need to tell you the story of how did this start. In front of all these great marketing websites, it will be quite funny, I believe. Okay, so we need to come back on my home in 2005. At home, okay, I had just a professional laptop, my desktop, a very small firewall called MonoWall. MonoWall is the father of BFWall or stuff like that. But I owned a server under my TV for streaming DivX file. It was an a French open source project called Jigbox. I don't know if you know about, but it's like a Kodi, but a very old one. This was my home. My need was to I want to found to put all my file, my document file, into a common place. This mean in a, like in a NAS server. So I try to search. I had an old server, old server, no, an old PC, and at this time there was two IDE ports with one master, one slave, so a maximum of four hard drive on this. And my purpose was to install an operating system on a USB key. Yes, the USB key was quite small at this moment. To boot from this USB key and to have a difference between the operating system and the data hard drive. So I tried to search on the internet because I found two open source software or free software. NAS Lite is a free software. It boot from a floppy disk. Yes, 2005. Okay, but it was very, very, very feature limited solution. And the second one was OpenFiler. It's a full Linux distribution, so quite big for my small USB key. Then let's try to build this software myself or this solution myself. But why having this crazy idea? I was a network guy, so very specialized network guy. So I was just a Linux user for sending my telnet and my SSH access to my routing device. I have no idea about technical advanced idea about Linux. I've wrote perhaps one or two Perl script in my life before. But I want to evolve, or I want to become a more polyvalent, a more generic guy. So my personal purpose was to learn about operating system. So doing a project like that, starting a project is a very good idea to have when you have goals for learning operating system stuff. So I try to search. So remember, I have a Jigbox, my DivX, my media center at home. It was a French system, so I go to on the forum. I ask a question. If you check the date, it was just October 13. And I have a question. Hey guys, I would like to create a open source software. How hard is this? How many time it consume? And what's the minimum skills? What do you need for this? They answer quite rapidly. The first answer was say, hey, we already have this idea. You can try to download our source of code and you can try to hack it, or you can try with BusyBox. It's very great. In few minutes, you will have a starting point. So I said, okay, I'll try. Remember, I'm not a software developer at this moment. So their source code was the revision, so the software was GNU Arch. I have no idea about what is a subversion, a revision concept at this moment. For me, a source code was just a tar file that you download and you use it. So I was not able to use this software to getting the source code. So I think it was okay. I didn't understand why I need to use a so complex tool just for getting text file or source file. So I try to go to the BusyBox website and try to download BusyBox. But at this moment, you have to compile BusyBox to use it. It's not just an executable or bootable binary. You have to tune it. I failed to do that too, because it was too complex. Okay, let's try again. One day I had to leave for 1 week to a training remotely. And before to leave, I just set up a VPN. I enabled the VPN, my monowall, my firewall at home. By setting this VPN, I say, but this is a small computer, it's a small device. He boot on flash, and the web interface is quite sexy. It's very easy to understand. So why not forking this stuff and trying to transform it to a NAS? Perhaps it's more easy to hack existing software for that. So just before leaving to my training, I download the code of that. I had a lot of chance because Monowall, there is a developer handbook, and the guy explained how to build a monowall from scratch. And this is great because I just have to install a strong Linux called FreeBSD, and I just have to copy to create a memory disk, and to copy binary file on this memory disk. And after Monowall have a script which use LLD for checking all the binary the library you need, and you copy it and it's done. And I get the so my first exercise was to build Monowall from scratch. But when I did it, it was so easy that I just replaced the firewall feature by Samba at this moment. And yeah, I forgot my first FreeNAS. So from October 13, we were October 88, I had my first release of FreeNAS. It's just a hack of Monowall. I just have to find a name. Okay, I'm a lazy guy, so well, FreeNAS, okay, why not? And I put it online. For me, if you build an open source project or if you build a fork, you have to push it online. This is why I did it. I created a website, but I didn't have any intention to continue this project because, okay, I got my NAS at home. It was working for me, so great. The project is done. I can do something else. But so I even created a website. I love Putty, I don't know how to pronounce this in English. So it was a very small website, very efficient website. So I did the same thing for FreeNAS and done. It was my first involvement in open source projects. So the first one, I received some mail, a guy who proposed me some logo. It was an Australian who gave me a full Word file with all the user guide in native English. It was great. I got some requests on 1,000 downloads. For me, it was the standard stuff. I had no idea it was quite non-normal for a software because I cannot compare. Now I can compare. It was totally crazy, but I have no comparison. So for me, it's okay. Great. User asks me question, I answer to them, no problem. Second month, yes, I've got some serious business because appliance seller called me for, okay, can we sell appliance with FreeNAS on it? I say, oh, guy, you didn't read the code because it was a very fun code. Okay. On the third one, yes, I got lots more download than a webmaster, but I still didn't understand exactly what's happening, what happened and why at this moment. The very big surprise was VMware start a challenge for the best virtual, the ultimate virtual appliance challenge. Just for fun, I filled the paper. I didn't read exactly what I need to do. It was mandatory to include the VM tools. For the moment, I didn't do that. I just filled the paper and I found FreeNAS with that. Okay, it takes me 30 seconds, I believe. But other people read the rules and they fork FreeNAS just for adapt to the specific challenge. And they win the first prize. They never contact me. I have no news about them. But I believe VMware noticed this quite of that it was just a fork. So they called me and they give me a consumer price. I was very happy because for my just for filling a form, I was very happy. And I give a majority of this price to the Manuel Capsa, the guy who created MonoWall. I call him back and I give him a part of this money, because for me it was the freelance was just a very rapid hack to MonoWall. It was MonoWall is a very big part of freelance of this freelance. But I start to understand at this moment that something strange was not normal with freelance. I received a mail from AMD. The mail was very short. It's, hey, do you know if freelance run on AMD? I don't know. Okay, here is a server. I received by FedEx, big stuff at my home. Okay, can you try? So I take the FreeNAS USB key, I boot, it's boot. Okay, it's running. Great, thank you. You can keep the server now. Oh, great. It's very noisy stuff in your bedroom. Really, don't. It's, so this is. And after 2 years, so, okay, without. I fall into the freelance management, managing the community, the open source community, learning more about how to manage, how to put the code in Subversion and stuff like that. I had to learn all this stuff in the same time. It was quite interesting. Not interesting, because if some user asks me, hey, how to integrate freelance with a Windows Active Directory, so I had to install a Windows to understand how working for okay, something were fun, some a little less. I had to pay a lot too, because with the success of FreeNAS, I had to protect the name because there is some typo squatting domain or stuff like that. So I spend money, I lose money with American trademark stuff, because when the guy tried to check, he just types the name on Google and for checking if it's a generic name or not. And when he sees the success, he said, no, it's a too generic name. I try to have a phone call with him, and no, since I didn't want it. FreeNAS is a generic name. There's too many answers with Google, so you cannot register it. But I asked the guy, check all the answers, he will see it's related to FreeNAS, but he didn't want to do that. Okay. I lose $400. Okay. yes, what's the... Oops. No, this one. Yes, it starts... Okay. I was alone with a second contributor, a German guy, who helped me a lot, and he is a real developer. So he wrote code faster than me, and often I was not able to understand his code after, but it was interesting. And yes, and I can have, it started to have a big impact on my family life. An example, 1 week I had to go to live with my family. But the Friday, I received a mail from the Japan CERT team saying that I got a big security issue. It was just, there is a web page for sending command line on the FreeNAS. On FreeNAS, the web server run as root, because, okay. And the web server is a root for starting. On the web page allowing the user to send command, I forget to include the authentication. It's just a detail, but okay. So it's very major bug. You have root access to FreeNAS without any. So, okay, I had to live with my family for the weekend. What can I do? Should I let all my users with this big problem? I'm not paid to work for FreeNAS. Or should I fix the problem and try to argue with my wife that I will do something else this weekend? So it became quite hard to manage because it's just a hobby. I've got a real job today. FreeNAS, I'm working on the weekend, on the night. So it became quite hard. So I have the opportunity from the crazy job. So I transfer the role to the project management role to my main developers, and so I can have a pause to work for FreeNAS. And during this pause, I had time to think about FreeNAS. FreeNAS based on MonoWall. MonoWall is a memory disk. The image is a memory disk, compressed memory disk, and you include this memory disk in the almost in the kernel. So it's very hard to modify or to customize this first generation of Freelance. And lots of users ask me, okay, can I have a print server? Can I have a BitTorrent client? And I didn't want that, because for me, a NAS, it's a NAS. It's a huge server file and nothing else. But it's an open source project. So I would like to offer the users the opportunity of create their own plugins for doing what they want with Freelance. But if you do that, at the end it will become just a server with a graphical interface, no more just a NAS. I don't know if Webmin is still existing, but at the end, Freelance will be just a Webmin, a graphical interface, on top of a BSD or a Unix system. I didn't know if it's a target I had to, I had lots of questions. The big question is, I never touched a NAS in my life. I've got no experience about NAS. I learned lots of stuff when I received the feature request. One of the first on the question, I believe, was, hey, can you add a snapshot feature? I have no idea of what was a snapshot. When I talk about FreeNAS the first time on BSDCAN, it was in 2007, I believe. It was my first attending to a meeting with lots of BSD guys. I go into a room by randomly, and there was this guy speaking about ZFS. And I said, wow, what's this file system? I had no idea about what was ZFS before your talk. You made a demonstration about, I believe it was dynamic red Z growing or stuff like that. I believe it was this. And I said, wow, this is quite cool. I'm not a storage guy, I'm not a system guy, and so I'm discovering stuff too late, I believe. So I'm not, the conclusion was, I'm not the good guy, perhaps from the beginning of FreeNAS, yes, but it became too serious for me. It became a serious business, so I cannot continue with FreeNAS. So we talk, because it's an open source project. We've got a public forum. We talk publicly about that. The main developer at this moment say, hey, I'm a Linux guy, so why not switching on Linux? I say, my answer was just, yeah, why not? You can try. because I try to not to have a very, to keep an open mind. I just answer, why not, on the public forum of FreeNAS. And this was crazy, because this news of, yeah, FreeNAS will switch to Linux have a big impact on all news websites and stuff like that. And I don't know why, but okay, if I want. A big buzz. And I received lots of mail about it. And in one mail, I received a mail, Matt Hollander, from EX System. I was aware about EX System because I know they are building it was called PCBSD at this moment, and they are selling hardware. And he asked me, hey, we can help you to reward FreeNAS. We will help you. I said, wow. But I said, okay, I've got a better offer for you. Here is the trade name, here is the domain name, here is the key, the admin key of SourceForge. Take all. I believe he was surprised. I don't know, you were at XSM? I don't know how Matt reacted to this. But okay, I say, okay, take all. And I believe I did a good choice, because XSM wrote for us, and it's quite become a cool product. So yes, hopefully they save me. And now FreeNAS is praised as a historical branch, I would say. It was called NAS for free, but now they renamed. There is the FreeNAS concept. And the main developer, the German guy, created Open Media Vault. And now is from a project, it's spread. It's great. I like that. Lots of different stuff, and just by the accident. So after FreeNAS, what can I do? Because my nights are very empty now, my weekend too. So I have lots of conclusion. First, I hate web UI. On the second, I'm a network guy, so I tried, okay, with all the stuff I learned about NanoBSD, FreeBSD, my decision was, okay, now I will create a new project, but based on routing stuff, with no web UI. When I started this project, one of my first tasks was, okay, I will offer a BSD optimized tune for routing. But when you say tuning, I had to find how to correctly tune a FreeBSD for routing. I tried to look on Google, and you have lots of answers about, and people give you magical value, but hey, you should use this value for your mbuf size or stuff like that. And I didn't understand this because I say, hey, what is a magic value? Why is this value one another? So I try to dig on FreeBSD. I try to build my own benchmark lab. How to prove scientifically that which will be the best value, tuning value, how to correctly tune BSD. And I found myself to generate a lot of benchmark on FreeBSD about the impact, about the firewall, different firewall stuff. And this is a job now I did for the FreeBSD project. Regression test about the performance, about the routing performance. And this is quite, it's not easy at all. I had more than, about 20 years of experience in the network. And it's quite challenging doing benchmark from scientifically, very serious benchmark, I will say. It's very, very hard. Even if you manage the domains, network stuff, which by my case, it's not easy at all. So I spent time for that. For Orange, because I've worked privately from Orange, I'm using this project. It was for using BSDRP or NanoBSD. The goal was to generate an appliance, a plug-and-play appliance for all our office in the world. So I built using this. It's a box. So you send the box with a factory default on the box. Once you will find internet access by a simple DHCP request or something like that, he bring up OpenVPN, a tunnels. And so on your control, you have all the, I call that unregistered box in your web page, who are displaying in different places of the world. And you check with their serial number, stuff like that, if it's the correct client. And you just push a button, and you send the certificate, the definitive certificate of the box. And it's like a plug and play and very automated way of managing thousands of boxes all over the world. And this was just a stuff I did using a BSD router project. But it's just a NanoBSD with OpenVPN and Ansible stuff around. It's very easy to do that. And the purpose was to demonstrate to my employer that today you can, with open source device on very cheap, inexpensive x86 device, you can do lots of network hardware stuff. But they didn't like that because it's not enough expensive, so they refuse it, but okay. But I have fun to do that. And I add a feature like a multi-customer feature with, I start with Phi, but now I try with jail on the VNet jail feature, VMage feature stuff, so you can do lots of very interesting stuff with, but okay, that's it. This was my last project. But now I will begin serious business. Okay, that's it. So yes, the answer is resume. Yes, if you are not a developer, but you just need the idea today, no one will read your code. So really, I can prove it. No one. They don't care. They use it. They don't read it. So you can do what you want. Even if it's very dirty, you don't have to be ashamed of do it. Just do it. Okay.